Sam, why didn't you sit down, please?
I'm a person of colour. Don't brighten me out. Thank you very much.
So, who are you?
God, that's a really good question. I'm Tan France. What else do you want to know?
People know me as a stylist and presenter on the global hit show Queer Eye.
I am the person who bolsters self-esteem through clothing.
Check me out.
My hope is that I get to teach people how to love themselves.
But what people don't know is that I've had to struggle with my own self-image and fight something called colorism.
Just keep going.
My whole life. It's where you're not only judged by the color of your skin, but by the shade of it. How light or dark you are.
His grandmother compared me to the color of a paper bag and said that I was too chocolate and he couldn't date me.
It's pushed many, including me, to the brink.
What is it?
I started to peel heavy layers of my skin off.
It's the reason why I left the UK to start a new life in America.
It was without a doubt the moment that made it so clear to me, if I don't do something to be less Asian, they're gonna kill me.
At a moment when racial equality is high on the agenda, I'm going back to Britain to ask difficult questions.
At birth, like, you're going to be a failure.
At what?
At life.
Life?
At life.
How deeply is colorism ingrained in our society?
I can't wait for EastEnders tonight. I'm going to throw bananas at my TV.
How much has history played a role?
Is it socially conditioned in a really deep way that has lasted for centuries?
And will I finally be able to come to terms with my own troubled past?
I was ashamed of my ethnicity. Yeah, I was ashamed of my colour.
This is called a Shirvani. I wore it to the Emmys, one of the years we won, and it was just a reminder of how I should be proud of my culture and ethnicity. Isn't that gorge?
Over the next week, I'm planning a trip to explore a deeply personal subject that's had a massive impact on my life.
Colorism for me is how one is perceived based on the shade of their skin. So, depending on how light or how dark your skin is, dictates how you are treated. If one isn't light enough, they're not going to be successful.
The pressure to be lighter can come from white people, but also from your own community. It's a pressure which led me to bleach my skin.
Just because some people might consider me light-skinned does not mean that I don't have a lot of experience with colorism. I've been surrounded by colorism my entire life. I felt so determined to change my skin color when I was a kid. And so, who better to talk about this than somebody who has literally bleached themselves?
Colorism is something that's only recently started to be talked about, but I have my own reason for wanting to understand it now. In just a few weeks, me and my husband Rob are expecting our first child.
The baby is due in 7 weeks, and we are nowhere near ready. Oh, what is that?
This is...
Oh, the little bouncer
thing. I think it's the
thing.
Little bouncer thing, yeah.
Oh, gorgeous. The thought of being a parent and bringing my son into this world, I want to do all I can to make sure that he doesn't feel the hurt and pain that I felt.
Really?
And the thought that my child would want to bleach his skin because he thinks he's not good enough and he will not achieve success because he's too dark makes me feel physically sick.
For the last 15 years, America has been my home. But I need to go back to where my story began, thousands of miles away in the north of England, to a town called Doncaster.
I left Doncaster behind a long time ago, thinking I will never return here. I went through a lot of traumatic experiences here because of my skin. I feel like the only way I'm going to make peace with who I was and who I am now is by going back to Doncaster and laying it to rest.
I've made my career in the US, the land of opportunity, where you can be anything you want to be. But it's also a place where image really matters. So before I leave, I'm meeting someone who's at the top of their game in an industry where you are constantly in the spotlight. I'm on my way to meet Kelly Rowland. Kelly used to be a member of Destiny's Child. She is now a solo artist. She released a song a couple of years ago called Coffee. It was a celebration of black women, and in particular, darker skinned women. Okay, Kelly, step through. Thank
yes.
you.
Yes.
If you would like to take a seat for me.
Thank you.
In our cozy space. Do you remember the first time you heard the thing that you are referring to as colorism?
The first time I had a little boo friend. Actually, his grandmother compared me to the color of a paper bag and said that I was too chocolate and too dark chocolate for him, and he couldn't date me. And I said, what the hell? I literally was like, what does that mean? And I came home and I talked to my mama T about it. And she said, that's a definition of colorism. And I was like, what is, you know what I mean? It was like that moment.
Okay.
It affected me in a way where I was just always uncertain of how I looked. It started to define what beauty was to me.
Okay.
In the entertainment business, it manifested itself in constant comparisons. When it came to like my skin color, I was hearing everything left and right. Well, you know, she's darker, or she's the darkest one in the group, or she's a really chocolate one. I would always hear that.
Was there ever a time where you thought, maybe I should try a bleaching cream?
I never actually thought to myself, I want to do a bleaching cream, as much as it was, oh, I just want to be Mariah's shade. Because that was who I, you know, that was who I was
yeah,
looking up to.
Gorgeous.
She's gorgeous.
Yeah.
You yeah. dance around in fields with da 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 da. I was like, life looks beautiful.
We've all seen what's happened over the last couple of years with the Black Lives Matter movement. However, we don't really see much about colorism, but it's a massive problem within our communities.
It's been the said unsaid. I think that it makes a lot of people uncomfortable. And I think that if we make ourselves aware of it, then we can actually move on.
It's so upsetting to hear Kelly's story about the brown paper bag. This was a test used by the black community in the early part of the 20th century to exclude darker-skinned black people. If you were lighter than the paper bag, you were allowed into certain social circles, like fraternities and churches. If you were darker than the bag, you were banned. A number of light-skinned black people also controversially pretended to be white to escape racism and oppression. This was known as passing. This idea of light-skinned privilege in the black community goes back even further to slavery, where light-skinned slaves were given better jobs in the plantation house, while those with dark skin were forced to toil in the fields. I'm back in Britain and I feel a mixture of excitement and dread. The UK is where I grew up and had to deal with colorism on a daily basis. On the surface, it's a very different country to the one I left, with five MPs of South Asian heritage on the front bench. I love being back in London. London's one of my favorite cities in the world. England has a fusty smell, like it's a musty, fusty smell. But it doesn't make me feel anything other than just joy to be back. I love it. Racism is different in the UK versus the US in general. I think that the problem is that the Brits aren't willing to admit that we have a massive systemic problem in the UK.
Hello.
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 When I was growing up, there were so few brown and black faces in public life.
Hello. Yes.
I remember being so excited to see Connie Hook on Blue Peter. Now, there's a black judge on Strictly, a South Asian presenter on Countryfile. Things seem to be looking up. But what's the reality of being dark-skinned in the limelight?
It wasn't a big deal. But now you think you can do something.
Oh, okay. So this is all my fault, yeah?
I didn't say that.
I'm meeting Bwami Mijeku, an actress formerly on the TV soap EastEnders.
It's actually not very common that people in my world talk about their experiences of colorism, so I'm glad that we've found somebody who's willing to say, this is what happened.
Hello.
Oh, that's
her.
Hi.
Hi, Bwami, how are you? Nice to meet you.
You too, how are you?
So well, thanks. You must be Manuel. Yes. Hello, yes, mate, hey. Nice to meet you. How are you? Tell me about your experience with acting, first off. Did you enjoy it?
Yeah, I love it.
Okay.
Like, it's always been my dream to be on EastEnders.
You deserve somebody who loves you for the funny, sweet, beautiful young man you've turned into.
While it was a dream come true, I received a lot of backlash. It just got so vicious. If Sir David Attenborough said Mercy from EastEnders was actually a silverback gorilla, I'd believe him. My sister said Mercy from EastEnders is so dark, she has to adjust her screen. I can't wait for EastEnders tonight. I'm gonna throw bananas at my TV.
Fucking hell.
They would just make reference to me, my complexion, and my size, and reckon me towards animals. Mm. And that is when we go into the world of what it is like to be a dark-skinned woman.
Yeah.
On screen and in real life.
Were most of the people that tweeted those people of colour?
Yeah, all of them are black, yeah. The abuse I was suffering from was really mainly centred around my community, the black community within the UK. So it does hurt a little bit more when it comes from inside the house.
Yeah,
it does.
She very bravely shared probably what were the most traumatic moments of her life. Our experiences are very different. I want to understand that you cannot conflate the black experience with the brown experience, but when we strip it down to its core, it's our own people saying that we are not worthy unless we are light-skinned. It's a message that if you are not white enough, you will not succeed.
Will passengers intending to travel on this service please join the train now?
Today I'm heading back to my roots in the north of England to face my own past.
Okay, I'm gonna do a selfie. Okay. Thank you so much.
Thank
nice to meet
so
you.
Much.
Thank you so much.
Like millions of other immigrants, my parents stepped onto British soil in the late 1950s, settling in Doncaster. We may have left the mother country, but our community elders, known as the aunties and uncles, held on to old ways of thinking.
Typically, in my experience, when you're in an Asian family, you're always reminded of the fact that lighter is seen as more beautiful. The color of somebody's skin, the shade of somebody's skin, is a concern from literally the day they're born. Lighter means beautiful, darker means unattractive. And it was everywhere. It was in the movies we'd watch, which were Bollywood movies. They were always beautiful, light-skinned people who were the stars of these movies. We used to have horrible names for some of our extended family members who were darker skinned. We'd refer to somebody as Cocoa Pops, or they eat too much chocolate, and that's how they got darker skinned. There was chit-chat about this person might not get married, or will you be able to get a good job? That was a conversation that was ever present in my life. It's not how smart you are, it's not how kind you are, it's are you light enough to be taken seriously? That screws you up. The one thing that was a constant as a child, being aware of my skin tone. It never went, there wasn't a moment in my life for 17 years where I didn't think about it. It couldn't get more personal.
But the pressure to be someone different wasn't just coming from my own community. In Yorkshire, I felt it when I stepped out of the front door. Growing up with immigrant parents in a traditional household, I had to just accept we were brown in a white world, which we were all trying to fit into. Even if it meant wearing jeans outside the house, then changing into South Asian clothes when we got home.
those differences that we had from the white population at school were the things that were made fun of. We had Pakistani food at home, therefore our smell, the way I spoke was a little different. I had a bit of an accent. We spoke English, but also Urdu at home and Punjabi. And so I felt ashamed because I couldn't just fit in. I didn't feel normal like everybody else did. I was ashamed of my ethnicity. Yeah, I was ashamed of my color. I think for most Caucasian people, they don't have to think about their skin. I can't imagine that that's much of a consideration at any point when they wake up every morning. But for me, that was something I thought of every day when I woke up. I thought, oh, what trouble is my skin gonna get me into today? And so at 9, I was already making grand plans to bleach, to do all I could to be as non-Asian as possible.
Bill Clinton has won. He will be the next president of the United States.
I had one cousin, and I knew she was using bleaching cream. I knew where she kept it, and so I stole that from her. I did it behind a locked door. I put on a generous amount. It stung. Over the next half an hour, it starts to feel like you've got actual sunburn. It just felt really uncomfortable, and so I stopped using it. Doncaster, where I grew up, always felt like a hostile place for me. My family don't live there anymore, and it's been a long time since I've returned to my hometown. I honestly don't know if I'm ready to go back, so I've decided to stay in Leeds. Less than an hour away from Doncaster, a place I escaped to for so many fun nights out. Back in Yorkshire. Leeds, to be specific. I haven't been to this part of Leeds for well over a decade, probably two. But it's nice to be back. It's changed a lot. I'm wondering if my childhood experiences are a product of their time or if people are still struggling in that same way today. To find out, I'm putting a shout out on Instagram. I want to know what you think about colorism. Send me your opinions. Do you think it's wrong? Do you think it's okay? Are you really more beautiful if you're lighter skinned? Who do you think is to blame for colorism? Do you think you get on better in life if you are lighter skinned? I know that's a lot of questions, but I want to know your answers. When I was growing up, the pressure to be lighter felt overwhelming. But what about the modern generation? They seem different, more vocal and assertive, living in progressive times.
Thank you so much.
So do they feel the same pressure that I did in my community? I've come to a school in Leeds to meet with some pupils.
Hello, Mr. Bell. Hi, good to see you. How are you?
Good to see you.
Hello, everyone.
Hi.
How are you?
Good.
I know I seem like an adult. I promise I behave like a child. You'll be absolutely fine.
I was in school in the 90s. The actual action of colorism was present in my school. We knew who the darker-skinned kids were, and we would have words for them. I want to talk about colorism. I'm going to write a few things down. If you just want to throw out any words you want that you think play into colorism and racism. We had a word which was, in my language, gala, which means black or dark. Yes, young man.
In terms of colorism, the word blick was used a lot in school.
Can you spell it for me?
Do you know what that is? B-L-I-C-K.
B-L-I-C-K.
Kind of to attack someone for having dark skin and essentially saying that, like, you're so black that you're blick, and it's almost like, it's very much implying that you're unattractive, you're ugly, or like you're a joke, basically. Mm.
I don't think I've heard like a white person ever call someone else black. Mostly in my experience, like internal within our community.
Colorism, more specifically, like more time is within your own community, like it's people who look like you, but might be a slightly different shade trying to discriminate against you, even though you're within like the same ethnic minority.
Yes, young lady, hello.
I do hear it a lot where like, aunties, uncles are like,
distant relatives are just like, think they've got a place to say, oh, that's good, your daughters are like, they'll get married off and it'll be fine. Yes. And you hear it a lot.
You mentioned a word that I want to really quickly touch on. Aunties.
Yes.
They don't focus on their own children. They like to talk about other people's children.
That's like a trigger word.
It's as if I said the word Beyonce, like the excitement that that caused. All right. Most white people don't have a lot of aunties because they don't call random older ladies aunties.
Yeah. I've got a nephew and he was born in January this year. Aunties would call our phone and before the first question before...
Can we play a game? Was the question, how fair is he or she?
Ding, ding, ding!
Yay! What do I win? Colorism! Is a question, right? What does that mean?
To me, it means like the auntie is saying, you're going to be a failure, like because of your skin tone.
At what? Can you be specific? Marriage? Work?
At life.
Life?
At life. Like, you, just because you're of a darker skin tone, you're going to fail from life just because you're not light or fair.
I still don't think it's okay to suggest to a child that because of their skin tone, they're going to be unsuccessful. Telling them from a young age that you're too dark to be successful, then you're setting them up for failure.
The kids were fantastic. Eye-opening, really valuable, but incredibly sad that nothing has really changed. I don't know much in this world, but I knew that the aunties were alive and kicking even now. What is weird is the thought that these aunties or the elders are me. Like, these kids are young enough to be my children. And so the things that I learned at school, my generation learned within our communities, we're now the ones passing it on. When they talk about their aunties, they're probably roughly my age. And I just think, did we learn nothing? It seems like teenagers today are experiencing all the same pressures that I felt as a kid, and possibly more with social media. But it's not just in the UK that colorism is doing damage. My shout out is getting thousands of replies from people across the globe.
Hola, Dan.
My cousins usually joke saying that I was left long in the oven.
What surprises me most is that people in the Far East who I'd consider have fairer skin are some of the biggest users of skin-lightening products.
I don't think I've ever been this white before.
So often in the West, we see campaigns for anti-aging, anti-wrinkles, those kind of things. But often in the East, it's brightening, whitening. It's not necessarily anti-aging. It's much more important, it seems, in the communities of color to look white than young. It's become a billion-dollar business.
Welcome to one of my clinics.
This clinic is one of many in the Philippines offering a range of skin whitening treatments. I come at this from a Western perspective, but in other countries, this means so much more. Colorism is completely relative to the culture you're living in, and it's obvious that it's causing enormous emotional damage.
I'd like to talk about how I was treated by my aunt.
Oh, what a surprise! You want to tell me how you're treated by your aunt? God, apparently we just need to gather all these aunts up and give them some kind of training seminar.
She said to me that I was found from the dumpster. Therefore, I have dark skin. They would pray for your skin to be fair. Do I still feel or wish that my skin was a little bit fair? Yes. If you are watching this, thank you so much, because no one here talks about this and I really appreciate you letting me talk. Bye.
She's very sweet. Just her saying that even now she still wishes she was fair. It is so sad because it is lifelong. She clearly can't get away from it. sweet girl is... No matter how much I think she's trying to train herself to move past it, it's clear that she hasn't, and she probably never will. And the things that were said to her, the way she feels, was pretty much how I felt. Listening to these stories has triggered some dark memories from my own childhood. To this day, I do not understand why people from my own community, people who said they loved me, put so much pressure on me to be lighter. Was it just our elders' way of making sure we integrated into Britain? I feel like there must be something deeper at work here. So what am I missing? To help me find answers, I've come to speak to someone about the history of colorism.
So evidence of colorism on a global scale goes back centuries, if not millennia. So for instance, we can think in the context of South Asia, especially India, about the caste system.
I'm at Leeds University. I'm going to be meeting Professor Krishnan. She specializes in colorism. She understands colorism better than I ever will. And so hopefully I'm going to learn where this comes from. I've never researched any of this, so I am interested to hear what this professor has to say.
The caste system, many people have argued, was developed as a way to divide and organize and control labor. So it was this confluence of caste, occupation, and class, which led to a hierarchical system which differentiated people based upon their skin color.
Thank you so much for letting me join your class. I know very little about where these ideas of colorism came from, but I always assumed it was because of colonialism.
It's kind of that, but it's actually probably even deeper. I mean, part of the reasons that the British Empire was so effective in India and South Asia was because they had the pre-existing caste system. So when the British arrived, there was already this kind of system of organization. There were already, you know, kind of hierarchies. There were already rulers, and there were already kind of manual laborers. They were able to exploit that by forming alliances and partnerships with the upper classes, the upper castes, light-skinned people. We also know that the British tended to favor northern India versus south India. Northern India generally contains lighter-skinned populations. So what we see happening was this kind of hierarchy of color. So it wasn't just that different colors were seen as different, it was that some were seen as better and others were seen as worse.
Do you see an end to this ideology, this idea that someone is better than someone else because they have lighter skin than another?
I want to say yes, but I can't, because I don't think that's realistic. I don't think I would say it's hardwired. What I would say is it's socially conditioned in a really deep way that has lasted for centuries and is so ingrained in the fabric of so many, if not all, societies.
I bleached my skin, and I always have blamed myself and beat myself up about it.
I don't think there's value in demonizing people. They're the results of hundreds of years of social conditioning and cultural development, right, and cultural standards. If you think about it, at least since the time of empire, potentially well before that, these structures and these hierarchies have been ingrained in how our society is organized. So I wouldn't blame the child, I wouldn't blame anybody for doing it. What I would hope is that they'd be willing to kind of listen and hear, to forgive themselves and understand that, you know, this isn't like you're just a bad self-hating person who's decided to mutilate their skin. It's that you're the product of not just your culture, you're the product of a confluence of factors.
When I look back now on 9-year-old Tan ready to bleach, I still feel frustrated with myself, but now having historical context, it has made me think maybe there was no choice. Maybe this was always going to happen. This social conditioning that the professor speaks about has incredibly deep roots. It's a form of brainwashing that's hard to shake off. It can be seen clearly in a psychological experiment originally done in the US in the 1940s, which was repeated in 2012.
Children were asked to choose between a black and white doll and say which one they preferred.
I like that one.
They all said the white doll was better.
Which doll is the pretty doll?
But it doesn't stop there. Further evidence of what the social conditioning can lead to is filling my inbox, and I am shocked by what I'm seeing. People are taking extreme measures to become whiter.
And this is your whitening that body wash. It's very, very effective.
She's literally peeling off a top layer of skin. And the woman laying there is acting like nothing's going on. That is insane. This is literally torturing this person. You are actually stripping this person's skin.
And they're not just bleaching from the outside. This clinic in the UK offers intravenous skin whitening treatments. Over the course of sessions, their clients are drip-fed medication designed to combat liver disease, whose side effect is to lighten skin. It's completely legal.
It's shocking that people go to these lengths. It's shocking that this service is provided.
Another message which has caught my eye is from Daniel.
This kid has gone from being quite dark-skinned to incredibly light-skinned.
Daniel's recovering from a 7-year bleaching addiction that started in his teens, resulting in terrible skin damage.
Hello, you Daniel. Hi, I'm Tan, nice to meet you.
I feel like as a black man, I always think of my colour. I'm originally from West London. I was very, like, shelled as a child. So up until I was about 16, I was at home in front of the TV watching SpongeBob. Never had a clue about what was going on out there, social media, nothing. When I hit 17, I got my first smartphone. I was able to make Instagram, way more self-conscious than I was before. Yeah. And one day I got around a crowd of people that were bleaching their skin and I was introduced to skin bleaching. Within 3 days, my skin had lightened a few shades and we was going out and I started to get loads of compliments. My followers went up, my likes went up, my messages, people engaging with me went up. It was almost like a superpower. I was separating myself completely from who I was before. These are a few pictures of me.
Wow. Wow.
I would go through stages where my skin would be really red and pink and sore. I started to peel heavy layers of my skin off. My skin would even come off in the bath.
Oh my God. That is fucking shocking. That's insane. Go much further and you're to the bone.
After the burn, after people giving me the harsh truth, after like really looking in the mirror, it was genuinely time for me to stop. I'm gonna be real, it was hard. It was hard for me too, because I went through that addictive phase. Mm-hmm. And when I did that, I realized I don't need to be lighter, because those that I really care about
couldn't care less about that shit.
It was so jarring to see those pictures. And for me, skin bleaching is absolutely a form of self-harm. This is the first time I've spoken to a queer person of color about skin bleaching.
It's made me aware that for us, there's a double pressure.
Queer people, we feel that pressure also to be desired by men. Gay people want to be desired by men, so we feel those same feelings that women do. We want to do what we can to be more appealing. And for us, unfortunately, that means lighter skin.
Talking to Daniel reminds me of how I felt as a teenager in Doncaster. And I have a confession. Something I have never shared publicly. I didn't just bleach as a 9-year-old. I did it again when I was 16.
At 16, I wanted to date, and it was the first time I had the confidence to put myself out there and date. I wasn't brave enough to just ask somebody out. And so I joined a website as the only option I could think of to try and find somebody. Not one response. And I thought, well, the problem is that people still think that I'm too dark to be worthy of dating. And so I purchased skin bleaching cream. So I used it for a short period of time, a couple of weeks max. Yeah, I felt real shitty about it, thinking the only way I can get a boyfriend is by being white. What the fuck is going on? I'm accepting that I'm not desirable to anyone unless I'm whiter. And that fucked me up royally, mentally. I think when people think of self-harm, they think of something very different to skin bleaching. Now when I look back, I think, God, how did I think that wasn't self-harm? It's a very different version of it, but absolutely it's self-harm. In my story, I realize all roads lead to Doncaster. Growing up there, the loudest message I got from the world around me was that white is best. And the overwhelming emotion I felt was fear. It felt unsafe a lot of the time. Racism was all I ever knew. And we would get attacked for it. And I thought if I lighten up, if I have whiter skin, they won't maybe know to call me a packy. I thought that that would negate some of the racism. To be honest, I've tried to bury that chapter of my life ever since I left Doncaster when I was 18. But to make sense of my childhood, I need to find the courage to go back. Before I do this, I want to talk to someone who's always been a massive support. Kiri studied fashion with me at the local college. She's still one of my very best friends. She's been a part of my life for over 20 years. I think they know me, but she actually knows me. I've kept in touch with her more than, yeah, pretty much anyone in my life, and she's here right now. Hello.
Hello.
Hi.
You're
right. Really well, thank you. You look lovely. Are you freezing?
No, I'm all right.
Don't lie. We are up north. You waiting for some food?
I am.
Okay, good. Should we do this?
Yeah.
You have photos. I don't.
I have
Is
some
right?
photos, yeah.
And you brought
Are
them
you ready for these photos?
No, I'm not at all.
I'm going to come off worse than you.
I want to see what you brought.
Right. Trip to London.
Oh, no.
And I used to say to you, oh, but Tam was so stylish when we first met. And then look how big that bag is.
Look how big my ears were.
You grew into them.
I know, I really grew into them.
It's fine.
Wow.
This is the best.
Oh, I remember this. Look at how shocking I look.
You don't look shocking.
It is a shock.
Zoom in on you and not me.
You look adorable.
I was.
Yeah, you do. I am a very different coloured person. I skin bleached. Did you know this?
No. I definitely didn't know it.
I never talked about it. Ever.
No. I never knew.
I don't think it's why I look so different now, because I used it for a few days. So here, 16, 17, it was around about the time I started bleaching again.
Here?
Mm-hmm.
So you'd already bleached your skin before then?
At 9. And then this was when I started again. There's two issues. There's out of the house, you get called a packy, and that is what you expect.
Yeah.
Every day you just know, well, that's somebody's going to say it at some point. It's just where, in what situation. And then there's the other end of it, which is you get it in your own home. It's completely normal in our community to say, yeah, he's dark, give him some bleach. With constant racism and constant colorism, there was no getting away from it.
No.
And I'm going to South Yorkshire tomorrow.
Ah, oh, are you? Back in Donny.
Back in Donny. And I feel
nervous.
Really nervous.
Don't feel nervous. I mean, I think it's 100 times better now.
I hope so. My concern is, no matter how much I hear that South Yorkshire's changed, I still can't help that child in me thinking, oh my God, I'm gonna panic, I'm gonna cry, and then I'm gonna run. I don't know how one gets past that.
Oh, I don't want it to be crappy for you.
For the past 20 years, I've never been back to Doncaster Town Centre. It's been way too difficult. But I can't help feeling that sooner or later, I need to face my past. I've got to try and go back. So we're in Leeds, which is 40-ish minutes away from South Yorkshire or Doncaster, and it's amazing how different I feel here. My nights here, or my evenings here, were always fun. It was filled with dancing and laughter and great food, whereas going back to South Yorkshire, there were some fun moments, but it was laced with horrible experiences. It's been way over 20 years since I've been in the town centre, so I want to at least see what that's like, what that feels like to be in a place that I avoided so greatly.
But Mrs. Thatcher has become Britain's longest serving Prime Minister this century, and not one to miss a trick.
I always knew something was dangerous outside the house because our parents made it very clear we are not allowed out alone. My mum always made it clear, walk next to white women. If you can find a white woman with her children, you'll be safer. But I didn't really understand why. I just thought my parents were being overprotective. So this is the point here where you hit the road that leads all the way to South Yorkshire, Doncaster. This is the point where the dread always kicks in, thinking, okay, we're back. The closer you get to your hometown and the moments that you experience, the more nauseating it is, that's for sure. It was the first time I had to go to school on my own. And these men, they were men to me. They were definitely over 18, decided that they were gonna chase me and then kicked the shit out of me. I was 5, I was left alone afterwards. I knew the warnings, obviously, to run and find a woman. And obviously you hear the calls coming, so you start to shit yourself when you can hear somebody calling you a packy from a distance. But these fuckers were faster than me, obviously. I was a baby, I was a child. And I don't actually remember what happened. I just knew that somebody kicked me from behind. Well, I don't know if I passed out, but I realized I was on the floor and I had to get home. And I didn't tell my family because I knew that they'd be angry that I didn't run fast enough. My dad was a lovely man, but if something happened, he'd say, why didn't you fight back? Why didn't you run faster? But as a 5-year-old, but as a 5-year-old, you just want to be able to go home and tell your family that somebody fucking kicked the shit out of you. That it was. Oh, fucking hell. I'm going to take a minute.
Sorry.
This is the turning to Doncaster. We are not going to turn. Quite honestly, I just can't do it. It was
without a doubt, the moment that made it so clear to me, I've got to do something about my skin color. If I don't do something to be less Asian, they're gonna kill me. For me, the desire to bleach as a kid, it was self-preservation. It was absolutely about survival. It was making sure that I could get home from school as a child without being attacked. I was hoping that I would at least give it a go and try and get into Doncaster. Do I want to put myself back in that situation? No. This is definitely not just exclusively my trauma. This is the trauma of a whole community. Millions of people feel the way I do. I know that so many people have been, especially kids of the 80s, 70s, 80s, 90s. It's a fight for survival. This is not just my story. It's definitely a collective Asian trauma. For anyone who was born and raised in this country or raised in this country who is Asian, we all experience this. We don't seem to believe that it's important to remedy the experiences that Asians have experienced ever since they came here. It's not taken seriously. It's a, oh, they had a bad time, move on. They just need to get over it. No, I think that we need to make amends with the Asian community. I hate thinking about my past. On one level, I chose the easy option. I ran away to America. But it is becoming so clear to me that you cannot escape your childhood. And I can't keep pushing it aside. So I'm meeting a psychotherapist who helps people explore childhood trauma. I've never seen a therapist before. However, I think for this subject and for regressed or repressed trauma, I think that that is when a psychotherapist is needed. And so I'm interested to see if she can unearth some things that maybe I've even thought of. Hello, Charlotte, how are you? Hi. Good to see you.
Very good, thank you.
How have you been?
I was going to go to Doncaster. I was going to go to South Yorkshire. And as we got closer, it became very clear I wasn't going to be comfortable. I obviously still care. It's still very upsetting. I had no desire to get out of the car because my only experiences were bad.
You're talking about experiences that were the most traumatic were years ago, weren't they?
Yeah.
Although in years, if we measure time in years, that was a long time ago. But in your mind, it isn't, is it?
It's
because our minds are fluid and something that happened 25 years ago can be still clear as day.
Yeah.
But what you've also said is that when you've come back to the UK and when you've gone anywhere near Doncaster, it's still incredibly traumatising for you.
I'm not being back to England to revisit my past since I left. I don't remember a time where I thought, I feel perfectly safe stood here. You are taught from a young age that to protect yourself, you've got to whiten up or be more British. But then within your community, whitening up literally means whitening up. So you're not just British, you're also the palest version of an Asian person. Mm. Because if you're not that, what will you be? What success will you see? It became such an issue that I ended up bleaching at 9. I wish I could go back to that kid and say, you're the color that God made you. Accept that and move on. It bugs me that I caved. And it bugs me that I caved again at 16.
Do you think you're carrying a lot of shame?
I don't feel shame about doing it at 9. I felt like I felt somewhat backed into a corner and I wasn't old enough to understand what I was doing. At 16, I knew what I was doing. And I feel absolute shame about it. Now when I look back thinking, especially at 16, because I think I should have been old enough to realize that that was stupid, I'm really angry at myself because I know now that it should never have happened and I should never have given in. A lot of shame. Yeah. I don't think that'll ever go away.
But you still had a lot on your mind.
Yeah. Really. No, I did. But I was aggressive about everything. I was an angry kid at that age. I should have been more aggressive about saying, I'm fine the way I am. Who cares if these white boys locally don't like me?
You're being very hard on yourself, mm-hmm. not able to sort of be kind to yourself mm-hmm. when shame is an emotion mm-hmm. that's associated mm-hmm. with what's happened. It's quite common to want to push it away, forget about yeah. it, draw, block it out.
Yeah.
Can you have some compassion for yourself?
In other areas of my life, yes, but not that. Mm. Interesting session. Uncomfortable session, I'm not gonna lie. I am the person who encourages people to love themselves the way they are. The amount of times I've said on my main show, be kinder to yourself, I want you to see yourself through kinder eyes. I don't know if I can apply that to myself when it comes to skin bleaching and me bleaching myself. I still feel a lot of anger at myself for that.
I hadn't realized until I spoke to Charlotte how much the shame might be holding me back. Today has been the first step in coming to terms with my past, but I know it will be a long process. I'm leaving the north and traveling back to London for one last stop before I head home. So far, I've learned that our communities are partly to blame for our social conditioning, and that colonialism plays a huge part. But there's one powerful group that has played a pivotal role in perpetuating colorism, and it's the industry I work in. The gatekeepers of the entertainment and fashion industries have the power to define what beauty and success looks like, and it's fair-skinned people with Caucasian features who have always been seen as the standard.
I've worked in fashion for a long time now, since I was in my late teens. I knew that people of darker skin tones weren't the people that you'd see on Vogue, and they weren't the people who were representatives of beautiful people on our screens. There were maybe a handful, not even a handful, of darker skinned people that were seen as worthy of being perceived as beautiful, Naomi Campbell being one of them. But other than that, it was very rare that you would see somebody dark-skinned or somebody other than a white person considered to be beautiful. The idea of diversity being important is a very new concept, and the importance of seeing us as all equally beautiful is a very new concept.
Part of the issue is who's making those judgments. I hardly ever meet magazine editors, stylists, or publicists who are people of color. Since Black Lives Matter, the fashion industry has started to diversify, and I have noticed more black models. Just take a recent front cover of Vogue, created by one of the few black editors in a position of power. Is this a sign of genuine change, or is this just a one-off, box-ticking? I've been invited to a fashion shoot where I'm hoping to find out.
So I know about diversity in America, but I would love to hear about your opinion on diversity here when it comes to gorgeous black women like yourself trying to get a job.
Well, for me, I'm too light to be high fashion.
Okay.
And then I'm too dark to be commercial.
Was it ever explicitly expressed to you that that was a problem?
No, but in the images when I did get jobs, my skin was always lightened or darkened. It was never as I am.
Okay. Gets me real angry.
Oh, that's really lovely.
And what's the story for the people on the other side of the camera?
Liana.
Yes.
I wanted a chat.
Of course.
And you reached out for a reason.
Mm-hmm. So I have been working as a photographer professionally for about 2 years now.
Okay.
And I'd done this shoot, it was all looking great and everything, and when I delivered the pictures to the client, he then said to me, oh, I look really, really dark in these photos.
What ethnicity was this person?
So he was East Asian.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
He kind of started being like, I can't have people thinking I'm this dark and stuff. And me, obviously, as a darker-skinned South Asian woman, was was quite shocked at this because he was very, very like insistent on it. He kept saying, "No, look, I'm not going to pay you unless unless you go into Photoshop and lighten my skin and everything and do all of that." It was just such an awful experience. The things he was saying was implying that.
Dark is unsuspecting. Yeah.
Exactly right.
What is the response when you find out that somebody does want that now? Let's say, for example,
I refuse to do it. I have a clause in my contract that very clearly states there that any kind of editing that I do will never include anything like that, basically.
I really respect Liana for taking a stand. But for real change to happen, it'll take everyone, including those at the top of the industry, to do the same. If the next generation grows up looking at such narrow representations of society, what will the damage be? And if we carry out another white and black doll test in 10 years' time, will the story be the same?
I think it's the responsibility of the white community to start to embrace people of color and to show the diversity of our world. Again, we don't need white saviors, we just need people to accept that there are other colors and that they should also be represented.
And don't just take my word for it.
Up until this point, the people in power in entertainment, most of them are white. They have dictated what is seen as beautiful.
Yes, they have. You get no disagreement from me.
Yeah.
I think the industry as a whole is to blame. I'm not just like placing it on like one person.
Yeah.
I think that now is a time where they actually can save themselves.
Yeah.
It's not like just everyone else. Mm-hmm. It's like you have to make everyone feel included.
Yeah.
That is your job, period.
It is tragic that people are made to feel unworthy, ugly, and uncomfortable in their own skin. It's pushed so many of us, including me, to extreme lengths to alter who we are. On this journey, I've been working through my own feelings of shame and trying to come to terms with my past.
Who is this boy?
But it's a long road, and one I hope my newborn son, Ismail, never has to experience.
Hey, Grumpy.
I definitely feel more anger now about the situation, understanding just how deep-rooted it is and just how many people it affects. So many of us go through this. How the heck have we not put a stop to it by now?
This has to end here. If there was ever a time to break this cycle, it is now. I'm up for the fight, not just for my own son, but for all of us.
I would love for Ismail to live in a world where there's no reason to even explore colorism because there's no such thing. It's made me want to push harder to make sure that this is something that we work towards ending.
Details of organizations offering information and support with racist hate crime and mental health are available at bbc.co.uk/actionline.